Activated carbon has been used for centuries in industrial processes and in the purification of water. For decades, it has been used in the remediation of contaminated sites to filter pollutants from groundwater once pumped to the surface. It has only been in the last 8 or so years that scientists and engineers have created techniques to apply activated carbon directly to polluted aquifers using suspensions of activated carbon milled to superfine particle sizes. This colloidal activated carbon, when applied directly into the subsurface, effectively converts the polluted aquifer itself into a purifying filter. But how does all this work?
Activated carbon is a form of charcoal. Many types of water contaminants will stick to charcoal rather than staying dissolved in water. Activated carbon uses the same principle, but it takes it to an extreme. It's got the structure of a hard sponge, and within each particle there's a labyrinth of honeycomb tunnels, which gives it this internal surface area, an external surface area, on the order of 1,000 square meters per gram, which is nearly 100 acres per pound.
So how much contaminant will stick to activated carbon, and what governs this interaction?
This sticking to carbon is referred to as adsorption, where the contaminant is attracted to the carbon surface through physical and chemical forces. This adsorption is the result of a dynamic equilibrium governed by the chemical characteristics and concentration of the contaminant.
Scientists can estimate how much of a contaminant will be bound onto a given mass of activated carbon and how much will remain dissolved in water by generating an isotherm plot. This is accomplished by taking beakers of water with a known amount of activated carbon in them, then adding an increasing amount of contaminant to each, and allowing all systems to come to equilibrium at the same temperature. Carbon and water samples from each system are then analyzed for contaminant concentration and plotted in a graph. On the y-axis is the mass of contaminant bound to the activated carbon per mass of carbon. On the x-axis is the mass of contaminant dissolved in water. Once the data is plotted, a mathematical curve fit is derived. This is known as the isotherm plot.
The isotherm can be used to predict the relative concentrations of contaminant sorbed to the carbon and that remaining dissolved in the water. What's important to note is that at low concentrations of contaminant, in the presence of high amounts of activated carbon, we remain very far to the left on the isotherm plot, meaning that most of the contaminant is bound to the carbon, leaving relatively little contaminant remaining in the water. As more and more contaminant enters the system with a fixed amount of carbon, we'll move farther to the right on the isotherm plot, which indicates that relatively less contaminant is being bound onto the carbon, with a higher concentration than remaining in the water. As we go farther to the right and the carbon begins to reach its capacity, any further increases in contaminant will remain in the water.
To see how this relates to treating an actual contaminated site, let's look at this firefighting training area at an airport, where over time, the use of firefighting foam has polluted the underlying soil and groundwater with PFAS. Here, using an injection rig, superfine activated carbon is fed directly into the subsurface, permanently coating the aquifer pore structure with a thin layer of activated carbon. The groundwater is free to move through the aquifer as before, but contaminants are stripped from the water and adsorbed into the activated carbon bound to the aquifer materials.
Compared to pumping the contaminated groundwater above ground and filtering through tanks of activated carbon, this in situ or below ground filtration is much more efficient in contaminant removal. This is the result of the exceptionally high surface area of the aquifer pore structure now coated with activated carbon. The small size of the carbon particles offers much faster adsorption of the contaminants and a much higher residence time or contact time for the contaminant sorption to occur as the contaminated groundwater moves slowly through the colloidal carbon treated zone. Contaminants entering the first few centimeters of a fresh colloidal carbon treatment zone in an aquifer are rapidly stripped out of solution as they begin to absorb onto the relatively high available mass of activated carbon. Referring to our isotherm, at the moment we're on the far left. Over time, as more and more contaminant builds up on the activated carbon, we start to move to the right of our isotherm with relatively more contaminant beginning to remain in solution. As the contaminated groundwater slowly moves down gradient, rollover begins to occur. This is where the dissolved contaminants move forward onto the fresh activated carbon in the next few centimeters of colloidal carbon treated aquifer, where they are once again tightly adsorbed until more contaminant moves in, and so on and so forth. If the influx of PFAS to the colloidal carbon treatment zone remains unabated, eventually contaminants will roll over enough to break through the treatment zone. However, due to the efficiency of in-situ colloidal carbon treatment to sort PFAS and the relatively low velocity of groundwater movement, breakthrough of unabated PFAS plumes is not expected to occur for decades.
When such a breakthrough does occur, one simply has to apply colloidal activated carbon once again to begin the process all over, offering decades more of treatment. In most cases, however, the upgradient source of PFAS will be removed, capped, or otherwise treated. This, over time, will cause a continual reduction in the PFAS concentration, impacting the colloidal carbon plume treatment zone. In this case, the rate of PFAS rolling over greatly slows.
On many PFAS-impacted sites where the source will be treated, the colloidal carbon treatment zone can be designed so that the PFAS rollover is retarded to the degree that reapplication of colloidal carbon is unnecessary. Instead, the PFAS fluxing in will simply spread out on the colloidal carbon to the point where the relative contaminant to carbon mass is sufficiently low to avoid any appreciable dissolved PFAS leaving the colloidal carbon treatment zone.
The result? PFAS is dealt with once and for all. For more information, please get in touch or visit regenesis.com.